Hi, I'm Agent Jay-Z, and welcome to Jet City. So today, it's a Sunday, and we're at the shop at S&S Turbines, where this engine is being prepared for shipment. Now this is the LM2500 with some aircraft parts. So let's take a quick walk around of this engine. There's the inlet with the IGVs in the closed position. We've got the actuating ram with the lines going to it. The linkage bar, which moves each stage in unison. Okay. These are water injection lines. There are dual fuel nozzles. Where's one? Let's see. Dual fuel nozzles in the engine. So we're feeding the gaseous circuit with propane or natural gas. And normally the engine runs either on natural gas or liquid fuel. What we're doing with this engine is running water into the liquid fuel cycle or circuit of the fuel nozzle while we're feeding it fuel in the form of natural gas. It's a way to augment power and reduce emissions by cooling the temperatures of combustion. Okay, now the engine in the test cell stopped about here, which is where we put our jet pipe on the engine. So everything back from here is one of the subjects of today's video. Since it's the weekend and there's no work happening, I'm going to answer two questions in this video. One question that I get all the time in different forms and I keep answering, and I want to make a video answer for this. And then the second one is a relatively new question, but it's relevant because this is here. Okay, the question I get all the time is, how does the power get taken out of the engine? How does it get transformed from jet thrust or jet exhaust to mechanical power, which is torque times RPM? A lot of torque times pretty decent RPM. Power turbine does that. Its output is at less speed and more torque than the engine. This engine spins at 9200 RPM. This power turbine spins at around 3000 to 3600, depending on the application. And how does it do that? Well, with the handy help of a little whiteboard, I'm going to take a very quick drawing of the LM2500. There's the cases. And let's get a different picture for the shafts. Let's just do this like that. We've got a compressor, 16, 17 stages. We've got the combustors, no red, the combustors. And then we have what's known as the gas generator turbine. Okay, that's the engine. That's the engine you saw in the test cell. And in the test cell, it had our fancy looking jet pipe, weird looking thing, producing exhaust gases. Now, the engine as you see it here, as you see it right here, as we just walked around, I'll show it to you again in a few seconds, it has what's known as a power turbine. And it has, this power turbine in this engine has six stages. Okay, what we're looking at here is the back end, the exhaust exit of the power turbine of the LM2500. There is the output spline. It's quite large, as you can tell. So the maximum continuous rating for this spline is 66,000 foot-pounds with a peak transient load of 133,000 foot-pounds of torque. That's not bad. Connect to a very short output shaft, or it's a shaft, with that output spline in the middle of it. Right there is where I had my hand a few seconds ago. Okay, so this is the power turbine. PT for short. And that drives your mechanical load. Now this same core, the LM2500 core, right here, is a separate piece of equipment from the PT. And there are different types of PTs. The one we have here is a six-stage industrial one, We're going to go take a look at the five-stage aerospace one, or aircraft one. We also have a single-stage power turbine that would also fit this engine. Let's go take a look at those right now. Okay, for comparison, this is the six-stage industrial power turbine mated to the back of the LM2500. There's an insulation blanket. So there's the LM2500 there, mated to the 2500's power turbine for industrial use, six stages right there. And as we go outside here, this is the aircraft version of the same power turbine. It has five stages to allow for some residual thrust to be produced by the jet exhaust of this unit. Now it's full of water, it's stored outside, because being a five-stage aircraft power turbine, it is never expected to be used again. The engines that this is a part of are not used anymore. It does have some parts that may be useful, but all the turbine blades are different. The bearings are similar. Basically, it is very nearly scrap. We're not sure if we're going to be using it for anything, but we've got it here, at least on concrete. At least it's not sitting into the mud. Now, not all power turbines are slightly modified aircraft versions made by the original equipment manufacturers, because there are other issues besides commonality with aircraft parts. We've got a single-stage power turbine, and there are two-stage power turbines that are much simpler than a five or a six-stage. So they're more durable, the parts are heavier, they last longer, maintenance is easier, and rebuilding it is less expensive. So the large industrial power turbines sometimes look like the one we have right outside. And right over here we have the rotor from a single stage power turbine of similar output power to the aircraft five-stager. This is actually from a LM1500. Puts out about 15,000 horsepower roughly, but you can see the size of the elements, of the blades, and the disc is huge. See how thick it is? It's pretty big. This thing would spin at around 5,500 RPM, so it spins faster than the multi-stage units. And that's the output shaft. It has an output of a male spline on a shaft versus a female spline inside a shaft. This is another piece that it's very questionable if it'll ever be used, and that's why it's being stored out in the rain and getting dirty. It most likely will not be used for anything. It's just too nice to throw away. Okay, the second question we're going to answer today is about thermocouples. Somebody asked, why doesn't the engine have one thermocouple which tells you the temperature of the exhaust? Why does it have 8 or 10 or 12 all the way around the exhaust annulus? Well, why indeed? The thermocouples do two things. They tell you what the temperature of the exhaust gases are, but they also tell you what the exhaust gas temperature is right there. So we want to know what the temperature of the exhaust annulus is consistent. So this is the reading that you're getting off of all the thermocouples. The ideal situation would be to know the exhaust gas temperature everywhere in this annular space. And ideally, it'd be exactly the same. Okay. We don't live in an ideal world, so we want to make sure, to the best of our measurements, that we're getting a uniform exhaust temperature through the annulus. So I will draw the annulus. This is the shape of the gas path leaving the combustion section into the first stage of the turbine. Now let's just say that this fuel nozzle is blocked. And let's just say that the temperature is 800 degrees here, 800 there, 800 here, 800, 800, all the way to 650, because there's no fuel being burnt there. So what we have is what's called a cold spot. Now, any individual turbine blade is going through this path, and let's make it easy. Let's say if it's at 6,000 RPM, that's 100 times per second. 6,000 RPM, it's going like this. But to the turbine blade, it's seeing 800, 650, 800, 650, 800, 650. So every single cycle, it's got a 150 degree temperature drop. And it's only a fraction of a second, but it's there. So we're getting a thermal cycle of plus or minus 150, 100 times a second. So you get a thermal shock like that on a turbine blade 100 times a second, and it's running for hours, days, weeks, and months on end. It's going to cause fatigue on that turbine blade. And because all the other turbine blades are right behind it, it's going to cause fatigue on all of them. And it's going to decrease the life of the blades. It's going to increase the chance to the point that it's probably going to happen that one or more of those blades are going to crack and fail. That's a bad thing. So there's a spread of 50 to 100 degrees. Let's just say that it's 50 degrees Fahrenheit. If there's more of a spread than 50 degrees Fahrenheit, that sets off an alarm. And then the maintenance people are called in to take a look at it to see what's going on. What is going on? You want to have a consistent exhaust gas temperature entering the turbine, because if you don't, you're cycling those blades in and out of temperature, and that's not a good thing. You don't want them to break. Okay, I've done my best to clear up a little bit of confusion, and I hope it helped. Once again, thanks for watching.